Hi, I am Dr. Selvaraj, your surgical educator from Malaysia. Welcome back to my series of surgical teaching videocasts. These are meant mainly for undergraduate medical students doing the surgical clerkship rotation. I promise you will become competent in clinical problem solving and surgical decision making if you are going to watch these videos over and over again. Today, I am going to discuss one more cause for dysphagia, the Achalasia Cardia. This is one of the primary motility disorder of the esophagus. So after watching this video, all of you should be able to understand the causes for dysphagia, etiopathogenesis, clinical features, workup, management, and a new treatment for Achalasia Cardia. I've also included a mind map and a diagnostic algorithm and a treatment algorithm. So coming to the various causes of the dysphagia, it is broadly divided into high dysphagia and low dysphagia. In high dysphagia, there are functional causes and structural causes. The functional causes are mainly CNS problem like stroke, Parkinson's disease, myasthenia gravis, multiple sclerosis, myotonic dystrophy, and motor neuron disease. Coming to the structural causes for high dysphagia, it is mainly mural. The cause is carcinoma of the esophagus, pharyngeal pouch, and cricopharyngeal bar. Coming to the lower dysphagia, the functional causes are all the motility disorders like the Achalasia cardia, Chagas disease, nutcracker esophagus, diffuse esophageal spasm, and limited cutaneous scleroderma, that is called the crust syndrome. Coming to the structural causes of low dysphagia, it may be luminal. The main cause, luminal cause, is the foreign body obstruction. The mural cause is mainly carcinoma of the esophagus, stricture of the esophagus, maybe a benign stricture, or it may be a cancer also. Plummer-Vinson syndrome, Schatzky's ring, congenital atresia, that is esophageal atresia, and post-fundoplication, especially if the fundoplication is very tight. Coming to the extrinsic cause, in the structural cause, the extrinsic causes are mediastinal masses, that is compression from outside, the mediastinal masses, retrosphenogoiter, bronchial carcinoma, thoracic aortic aneurysm, pericardial effusion, Artness syndrome, and dysphagia lusoria. So coming to the history of Achalasia cardia, in 1913, Ernst Haller performed the first surgical intervention for Achalasia, and the procedure still bears his name. It was not actually called Achalasia until 1927, article by Dr. Arthur Hurst. This article is the treatment of Achalasia of the cardia, the so-called cardiospasm. Achalasia in Greek, it means lack of relaxation. Ellis et al. Described the first transthoracic approach in 1958. The first laparoscopic Haller myotomy was done by Professor Sir Alfred Kusairi in 1991. So he is Dr. Alfred Kusairi. So coming to the etiology for Achalasia cardia, it is actually the failure of the lower portion of the esophagus to relax during swallowing, that is defined as achalasia. The resulting dysphagia is due to three mechanisms. Number one, complete absence of peristalsis in the esophageal body, or aperistalsis. Number two, incomplete or impaired relaxation of lower esophageal sphincter after swallowing. Number three, increased resting tone of lower esophageal sphincter. Mainly it is idiopathic. Nobody knows exactly what is the cause for this achalasia, but in many cases there is decreased number of ganglion cells in the myenteric R box plexus. Another thing is the Chagas disease caused by trypanosoma cruzi. This also cause achalasia like problem because of damage to these ganglion cells. And another thing is called pseudoachalasia, which is caused by extrinsic compression of the lower esophagus by masses like tumors, hematoma, or enlarged lymph nodes. Achalasia means, I told you already, Greek, it is mean failure to relax. This is a normal esophagus, so normal esophageal peristalsis is there. When swallowing, there will be relaxation of the lower esophageal sphincter, so the food will easily, it will go into the stomach. Whereas in case of achalasia cardia, there will be impaired esophageal peristalsis and failure of the lower esophageal sphincter during swallowing, it is not opening, it is very tight. So food won't go into the stomach from the esophagus. So here there will be a functional obstruction at this level. So impaired this one, this is the dilated. So eventually the esophagus will become so much dilated, there will be loss of ganglion cells or decreased number of ganglion cells in the Arbex plexus of both the body of the esophagus as well as in the lower esophageal sphincter region. So coming to the pathology, the histological examination shows a decrease in the neurons of the myenteric plexus, that is the Arbex plexus. There is a preferential decrease in the nitric oxide producing cells, which contributes to the LES relaxation. There is a relative sparing of cholinergic neurons responsible for maintaining the LES tone. The loss of these inhibitory neurons lead to an increased resting tone in the LES. It also leads to aperistalsis of the body of the esophagus. All these things will result in elevation of intraluminal esophageal pressure that will cause esophageal dilatation, and subsequently there is progressive loss of normal swallowing mechanism that will eventually end up in the functional obstruction at this level. So coming to the clinical features, the main problem is, of course, the patient will present with dysphagia. This is the most common symptom of achalasia. Patients often report that food sticks in their chest. Dysphagia will be usually for liquids to begin with, and eventually they will be having dysphagia for solids also. They tend to augment the passage of food by drinking liquids. Another symptom is regurgitation because of the functional obstruction. The patient will bring out, this is what is called passive return of food to the mouth after eating, is called regurgitation. In 60% of the patients, there will be history of loss of weight. There may be chest pain in 43% of the patients, and there will be heartburn and halitosis because of the retained food and liquids in the distal esophagus will get fermented, and this will cause both the heartburn and the halitosis. Patient also will have pulmonary complications. This include cough and chronic aspiration. They occur in 10 to 30% of patients with achalasia cardia. So coming to the investigation, the onset of symptom is usually very slow and gradual. The average time between the onset of the symptoms and diagnosis is over 4 years. In patients with suspected achalasia, there are 3 important tools in diagnosing the achalasia. They are, number 1, barium swallow, number 2, upper GI endoscopy, and number 3, esophageal manometry. So coming to the barium meal, the classical features of barium meal include esophageal dilatation. This is what you are seeing here. Esophageal dilatation, loss of peristalsis in the esophagus, delayed emptying with a column of barium retained within the esophagus, and usually there will be a smooth tapering. Yeah, this is what you are seeing. This is dilated esophagus. There won't be any peristalsis in this area, and there will be a smooth tapering, and this will produce a classical bird's beak appearance. This is what you are seeing here and here, and also here, in all these 3 pictures, you are seeing the smooth tapering of the esophagus producing a characteristic bird's beak appearance. There will be, apart from that, bird's beak puffiness, there will be uniform dilatation of the esophagus. This is known as sigmoid esophagus or cucumber esophagus. In the chest x-ray also, you can see the mediastinal shadow. This is the dilated esophagus. This also you can see. Just behind the heart shadow, you can see air fluid level in some of the cases. That is also signify a case of Achalasia Cardia. Coming to the upper GI endoscopy, all patients with suspected Achalasia Cardia should undergo endoscopy to rule out malignancy. On entering the esophagus, it is usually very large and will potentially have retained food. That is what you are seeing here. It is quite an enlarged esophagus. Here also you are seeing the enlarged esophagus, but here you are seeing the retained food here. While the LES does not open spontaneously, usually you are seeing a contracted the lower esophageal opening, or GE junction you are seeing it is not opening properly. So while the LES does not open spontaneously, it can be passed. I mean the endoscope can be passed into the stomach with gentle pressure. Closed or tight LES on passage of the endoscope into the stomach, you can feel it. So coming to the esophageal manometry, this is the gold standard for investigation for diagnosing Achalasia Cardia. The classical findings include a peristalsis of the smooth muscle segment of the esophagus, where the contractile pressure are usually very low. Elevated resting LES pressure, often above 45 millimeters of mercury. Abnormal relaxation of the LES. The LES should drop to below 8 millimeters of mercury. Then only it will open. So usually this will be more than 8 millimeters of mercury, the pressure at LES. In Achalasia, LES relaxation in response to a swallow may be incomplete or it may be totally absent. This is the swallow. At the same time, it should open. The pressure should come down here. So it is not coming, it should come down below 8 millimeters of mercury. Then only the GE junction will open, the lower esophageal sphincter will open, and then the food will enter into the stomach. If there is a resting pressure in LES is very high, and if it is not relaxing, okay, that is the characteristic feature. On swallowing, here you can see the pressure is not, less than 8 millimeters here. The same recording, this also, here also you can see LOS is not relaxing here on swallowing. That is the characteristic feature in the manometry. Coming to the treatment, treatment is directed to relieve the symptoms and not to relieve the pathology. There are different treatment options are there. One is medical treatment, endoscopic treatment, and surgical treatment. Under medical treatment, you can give nitrates or calcium channel blockers, or the another thing is botulinum injection you can give. Endoscopy, you can do pneumatic graded balloon dilatation. Surgical, you can do Heller's myotomy or modified Heller's myotomy. So coming to the medical treatment, the nitrates are given sublingually. It can decrease the LES pressure and offer short-term relief to dysphagic symptoms. However, they do not affect the LES function and efficacy decreases over time. So it is only for temporary use. The calcium channel blockers, this also can decrease the LES pressure and relieve the dysphagic symptoms. However, as with nitrates, the function of the LES does not improve. Side effects are common and efficacy is only short-lived. Coming to the botulinum toxin A injection, the botulinum toxin blocks the release of acetylcholine at nerve receptors, and when injected into the LES, this leads to the relaxation of LES by inhibiting the function of the unopposed neurons that cause LES contraction. 3/4 of the patients respond to the initial injection. Efficacy decreases over time with multiple treatments, and recurrence is common after 6 months. Coming to the endoscopic graded pneumatic dilatation, compared to the botulinum toxin and medications, pneumatic dilatation is the most effective non-surgical therapy. It involves passing the pneumatic device to the LES using both endoscopy and fluoroscopy to properly place the balloon. The balloon is inflated to a pressure between 7 to 15 psi. Pneumatic dilatation forcefully disrupts the hypertrophied muscle fibers of the LES, leading to decreased LES pressure. Patients are usually observed for 6 hours and then they will be discharged to home. Complications include 1 to 6% of risk for esophageal perforation. So in the first picture here, you are seeing the botulinum injection. You have to, this injection has to be given through the endoscope. So you are using a needle and you are injecting. This is the dilated esophagus you are seeing, and this is the LES. You have to use the needle. The needle injects the botulinum toxin into the lower esophageal sphincter. Here you have to inject. Yeah, you have to inject here on both the sides. You have to, all around, you have to inject. Actually, you have to inject. Injection site is squamocolumnar junction. Just above the squamocolumnar junction, you have to inject. So the next procedure is the endoscopic graded pneumatic dilatation. So you have to pass a guide wire through this, very much obstructed lower esophageal sphincter. And over that, you have to pass this pneumatic dilator or pneumatic device. You have to pass into this area, lower esophagus, and then you have to inflate this balloon and keep it completely. The balloon is completely inflated here. You have to keep it for some time and then you can remove it, so that all the muscles here will be disrupted by this maneuver. So the patient will be, the dysphagia will be relieved. But both are, the effect of both these procedures are only short-lived. So the best procedure is, of course, the surgical intervention. That is called Hellers cardiomyotomy. The operation consists of splitting the longitudinal muscle fibers and dividing the circular muscle fibers of the distal esophagus at the area of lower esophageal sphincter. The myotomy is carried down onto the gastric cardia for 2 to 3 centimeters. The operation can be performed through the chest or abdomen and is most commonly done via with laparoscopy. A fundoplication is usually performed along with myotomy, because 30 to 40% of the patients, they will eventually develop symptomatic gastroesophageal reflux disease or GERD. So you can do either anterior DAR fundoplication or posterior 270 degree Taupe fundoplication. Both can be done. Myotomy lowers the LES pressure more reliably than medication, botulinum toxin, or pneumatic dilatation. So this is the Hellers myotomy. Of course, you have to do it. Now the current trend is you have to do it with laparoscopy. After this, this is the myotomy. You have to extend not only in the esophagus, you have to extend 2 centimeters below the cardiac end. You have to extend it well into the stomach also. This you have to extend it. And over that, you can put the anteriorly, the fundus of the stomach to the anterior, this division, you have to close it. This is called anterior DAR fundoplication. And another method is the posterior 270 degree Taupe fundoplication. So after this cardiomyotomy, you have to wrap the esophagus to the posterior aspect of the esophagus. And then you have to suture it, not 360 degree, you have to suture to the edge of this incision, and this is 270 degree wrap, that is called Taupe fundoplication. So there is another new treatment of late. This is called POEM, or this is also known as peroral endoscopic myotomy. The leading expert in this technique is Dr. Haruhiro Inoue. He is Dr. Haruhiro Inoue. You can see him here. Yeah, he is from Japan. He is working in Sawawa University of North Yokoyama Hospital in Japan. He used this endoscope with a special transparent cap. He starts by entering the submucosal space approximately 15 centimeters above the GE junction. Then, using a solution of saline with indigo dye, a tunnel dissection is carried distally to about 2 centimeters distal to GE junction. Then, myotomy starting at 10 centimeter proximal to the GE junction. The myotomy is carried distally down to 2 centimeter distal to the GE junction. Myotomy only takes the inner circular muscle fibers while leaving the outer longitudinal fibers intact. At the end of the procedure, the endoscope is removed from the submucosal tunnel and the entry site is closed with endoscopic clips. So this is what you are seeing as a diagram. This is the esophagus, this is the endoscope. So you have to create a submucosal tunnel. You have to go 2 centimeters distal to your cardia, and then you have to cut the muscle, the circular muscle, from here to here. You have to cut. And then you can remove the, you have to cut it, yeah, two centimeters, distal to your cardia. And then you can remove it and you can put an endoscopic clip here. This submucosal tunnel you can close. This is the endoscopic view, actual endoscopic view you are seeing here. This is he is creating a submucosal tunnel. Here he has created up to the lower end of the esophagus and gone into the, almost to the stomach. And here he is cutting the muscle, the circular muscle fibers, cutting here. And then here he is taking it out and he is going to put an endoscopic clip to close the submucosal tunnel. So this is the mind map. So what are the etiology? So etiology, mainly it is idiopathic. There is decreased ganglion cells in the R-box plexus. Chagas disease by Trypanosoma cruzi is another cause. This is called secondary motility disorder. And pseudoachalasia is by extrinsic compression by tumors or lymph node. Coming to the pathology, there will be aperistalsis of esophagus, increased resting tone of LES, imperfect relaxation of LES on swallowing, increased luminal pressure of esophagus. This will lead into mega esophagus, which is called sigmoid esophagus. So eventually the patient will develop functional esophageal obstruction at this level. Coming to the clinical features, patient will complain of dysphagia, regurgitation, loss of weight, retrosternal pain, halitosis, and pulmonary complication because of aspiration. Investigation, you should do the barium swallow that will show the classical bird's beak appearance. Upper GI endoscopy also you can do. You can also do esophageal manometry, which is the gold standard investigation to prove the patient is having achalasia cardia. Coming to the treatment, medical treatment includes nitrates and calcium channel blockers. You can also use botulinum injection. You can also use endoscopic pneumatic dilatation. All these three procedures are non-surgical procedures. Among the three, the endoscopic pneumatic dilatation is the best among these three. So coming to the surgical intervention, it is laparoscopic Heller myotomy or the newly developed POEM or peroral endoscopic myotomy. So coming to the diagnostic algorithm for dysphagia, if patient is having dysphagia, you have to do a thorough history and physical examination. If it is a sudden onset dysphagia, you have to do urgently esophagoscopy or upper GI endoscopy. This will reveal the bolus obstruction or foreign body obstruction. If patient is also having night cough and gurgling, then you have to order barium swallow that may reveal the pharyngeal pouch. If patient is having stricture but no pouch, then you have to do a esophagoscopy or apogee endoscope, and you must do a biopsy to rule out whether the stricture is a benign one or malignant stricture. If on barium swallow, if there are no stricture, then you have to suspect the motility disorder like achalasia cardia or the diffuse esophageal spasm. So this is a treatment algorithm for achalasia cardia. So it is medical treatment or surgical treatment. Medical treatment consists of nitrates and calcium channel blockers, primarily used in elderly patients when surgical treatment cannot be done. Botox injection, induction of botox in lower esophageal sphincter is done endoscopically. It is time limited and repeated injections are required. This is only, both these have only temporary effect. Coming to the surgical intervention, the endoscopically, you can do graded pneumatic dilatation. A balloon is dilated at gastroesophageal junction to rupture the LES muscle fiber, leaving the mucosa intact. This long-term outcome is good in 50% of the patients. Best thing is the Hellers myotomy. This should be done laparoscopically. It is considered primary treatment in most of the patients when the surgery can be done. It is the extramucosal cardiomyotomy. Good results in more than 85% of the patients. So another new procedure is the peroral endoscopic myotomy or POEM. This also you can do. Esophagectomy can be done if the patient is having very big dilated esophagus or mega esophagus. So thank you very much for watching this video. If you think that these videos are very useful, kindly subscribe to this channel and share these videos in your social media. Thank you once again for watching this video. Let us meet in yet another video. Until then, bye bye.